It's been 2 long, miserable weeks trapped in a coffin-sized box. He barely knows who he is anymore. The darkness is driving him crazy, his muscles are constantly contracting. Then somehow, the torturers learn of his greatest fear. They pour cockroaches into his coffin, where for the next few days they crawl all over him. And this, dear viewers, is not a depiction of torture in England circa 1550. This was the CIA not long ago. We'll come back to this fate later, but first let's get a handle on this thing called the blackout box. It's perhaps one of the most frightening things the Americans have ever come up with as a part of the CIA's enhanced interrogation methods, which just means torture that usually doesn't leave many serious injuries. It sometimes does, but if the victims' bodies aren't broken, their minds almost always are. That's the whole point with enhanced interrogation, to break a person down. Perhaps pulling out someone's teeth will hurt a fair bit, as will the old medieval technique of busting joints or burning feet, but if you can truly break a person's mind, then in some ways you own them. After all, this is enhanced torture. Things have moved on since Guy Fawkes was England's biggest terrorist threat. As we described, the boxes people were kept in acted like a coffin, but not all coffins were the same. Some were big enough so the person could just about kneel in there, but holding that position for any length of time in an enclosed dark space became extremely painful. The CIA called this cramped confinement. So let's just say numerous trips to the waterboarding bench didn't get any results, and no amount of being blindfolded and occasionally receiving a kick or a punch proved to be useless. Locking in someone in a confined space would seem like the right direction to go in. Some people can handle pain, but not many people can endure being forced into a cramped, dark space. Some of the victims of enhanced interrogation were completely innocent. One of them told the New York Times that since his release, he was having nightmares where he's suffocating at the bottom of a well. Another just said, "I'm living this kind of depression. I'm not normal anymore." In this respect, you have to say that such interrogation techniques work in terms of breaking someone. They break them possibly for the rest of their lives, though, and it doesn't really benefit anyone to break someone who has nothing of value to say. The coffin treatment was part of a technique developed by the psychologists who believed that the best way to interrogate someone was to make them helpless. This was part of a theory developed by an American psychologist in the 60s called learned helplessness. The theory went that once you broke a person's will and made them realize they were helpless, they would tell you anything. That is not always a good thing. Take for instance the story of Ahmed Errachidi, a restaurateur who was once accused by the US authorities of working for Al-Qaeda. He was later proved innocent of all charges, but first this man who suffered from bipolar disorder was interrogated at a CIA black site. The interrogations worked. In some ways, they were an outstanding success. Following a complete psychotic breakdown after being left in a cramped confinement, he told the authorities he wasn't just a terrorist, but he was the superior officer to Osama bin Laden. He probably believed this because he also said the world was about to be destroyed by a giant snowball. He'd lost his mind. A snowball-based apocalypse story wasn't much good to his interrogators. To make a person feel helpless takes time. You can't just pull out a fingernail. You need to be relentless, then give the prisoner a break, and then be relentless again. This will gradually cripple the prisoner's psyche. A former resident at Guantanamo Bay said, "I've been suffering from absent-mindedness, amnesia, inability to memorize, depression, helplessness, apathy, loss of interest in the future, slow thinking, and anxiety." This alone should tell you that while such torture techniques are primarily modern, they still deserve a place on the worst tortures in history list. Prolonged exposure to torture may not be as physically painful, but mentally the scars are deep. Let's now come back to the man whose box was filled with cockroaches. His name is Abu Zubaydah, and he's still being held at Guantanamo Bay without charge. He was also the first ever person to be subjected to the CIA detention program after 9/11. At some point in that program, he lost an eye, although a medical issue could have been to blame. We're not exactly sure. This is what former President George W. Bush said after he was detained. "The other day, we hauled in a guy named Abu Zubaydah. He's one of the top operatives plotting and planning death and destruction on the United States. He's not plotting and planning anymore. He's where he belongs." It's since been proved that he had no idea about the 9/11 attacks, and he was never a member of Al-Qaeda, although he was a non-Al-Qaeda-related jihadist. Today, we won't focus on his case, but we'll talk about how he was tortured. He wasn't just the first to face this new torture program, but he pretty much underwent the CIA's whole gamut of techniques, many times over. Since then, he's sketched the various methods of torture and, through his lawyers, talked about them. One of the many methods of tortures was called the large confinement box. He was shaved all over and naked and was put inside a box where he was chained on top of a bucket. The bucket served as his toilet. In his own words, he said, "I found myself in total darkness. The only spot I could sit was on top of the bucket, for the place was very tight." He was told before he was placed in the box, what he described as a casket, that this place was going to be his home for quite some time. Turned out the large box wasn't going to be the worst of his problems, though, because soon he was going to experience what it was like to be in the small confinement box. He described it like this: "As soon as they locked me up inside the box, I tried my best to sit up, but in vain, for the box was too short. I tried to take a curled position, but to no avail, for it was too tight." He said he was forced to stay in the fetal position because there was no place to move. That made the entire experience very, very uncomfortable. He said, "The very strong pain made me scream unconsciously." It was at some point in this box that the CIA threw in some company, the aforementioned cockroaches. We'll come back to those soon. Regarding the dimensions of the box, the large one was said to be the size of a coffin. He stayed in that for 266 hours. The small box was 21 inches wide, 2.5 feet deep, and 2.5 feet high. He stayed in that for 29 hours. As for how this would feel, well, you could imagine it would be horrific. But the BBC went a step further than merely imagining. One of its reporters tried to experience it for herself after a box was made for her. She said in a video, "I wanted to see how long I could last." It should be mentioned here that she knew this was an experiment and her interrogators were fake. Not knowing if you could be killed would be a different experience entirely, especially after you've already suffered weeks or months of beatings and humiliation. "This is going to be mind over matter. It's just a box," she said in the video. After 2 minutes, she was uncomfortable. After 10 minutes with recorded sounds of a baby crying being played into the box, she was in physical pain and looked as though she'd been made to drink in a Wetherspoons pub with working class folks, wild and unfamiliar to reporters at the BBC. She lasted about 12 minutes. She said panic set in. "I know what they mean now when they say everything has a breaking point." That was a paltry 12 minutes. Can you imagine how 1 hour would feel? The BBC reporter said that any longer than 12 minutes was unthinkable. US cables have now been made public by the media talking about the blackout boxes a little, but not so much as said. One of these cables said, "Comments re: likely psychological impact of the confinement box on the redacted process with AZ. And further comments on the construction in particulars concerning an additional confinement box for use during upcoming interrogation of Abu Zubaydah." Talking about Zubaydah's torture, another cable said, "The interrogators pointed to the small box and said, 'You know what to do.' The subject sat on the floor and scooted himself into the small box at 1000 hours without protest or additional instructions." The document explained that he stayed in the large box and then was put inside the small box. When he was taken out, he was slammed up against a wall, something called walling. At some point, the document states, the waterboard bench was pulled into the room. Zubaydah was told again, "You know what to do." After hours of this, he was asked yet again what he knew about the terrorist plot to harm America. The report stated, subject whimpered that he had nothing. From a black site in Thailand, a country very familiar with torture, a US cable said such interrogation techniques could help them reach the stage where we have broken any will or ability of the subject to resist or deny providing us information. It was added that such techniques should be used as a template for future interrogation of high-value captives. It seems the boxes could have been a technique used mostly in those early interrogations, because released prisoners have mentioned many of the other tortures, but not the confinement boxes. It was written in another document that walling and sleep deprivation were the best enhanced interrogation techniques, with someone writing, "The others, while occasionally useful, were not critical, and some, like nudity, slaps, facial holds, dietary manipulation, and cramped confinement, were completely unnecessary." But there are other reports which include information about how US interrogators used confinement boxes against a Libyan man, who the CIA later handed over to the enemy, the now deceased dictator Muammar Gaddafi. His name was Mohammed Ahmed Mohammed al-Sharoya, and when the CIA had hold of him, they would usually place him in a large coffin box. His hands were handcuffed to the top of the box, and for hours on end, they'd play loud music into it. Another prisoner said he sat there for 3 days on end, urinating and defecating inside. It seems the small box wasn't pulled out too often. The first guy said in the 2 years he was regularly tortured, only once was he subjected to the small box. He was only in there for an hour, but all the time the interrogators prodded him with objects through the holes in the sides. Needless to say, the CIA denied torturing those Libyan folks. Human Rights Watch responded that they were merely allegations, not solid proof. Still, according to one of those men, when he was in the tall box, he said there was just enough light to see what he said looked like bloodstains on the wall. He even drew a picture of the place and the box. As for how it feels to be on the other side of such torture, A former CIA agent cum whistleblower filled in the word on that. His name is John Kiriakou. He was asked many years ago by a higher-up if he wanted to take part in enhanced interrogations. When he inquired what that involved, he was told it would mean getting rough with detainees. He said he had a moral and ethical problem with it, to which he was informed that he demonstrated a shocking lack of commitment. He was the only person out of 14 CIA officers who turned down the opportunity to turn up the heat on interrogations. He later said about his brothers in arms, "These officers were friends of mine, people I socialized with. My kids played with their kids, and then, like flipping a switch, these officers could become monsters. I didn't understand how they could turn it on and off like that." As we all now know, people can commit horrendous crimes when told to follow orders. Just following orders is what Nazi officers said when standing accused of forcing people into gas chambers. Still, Kiriakou said the CIA won't hire sociopaths, such people can't be controlled. But when the officers are told this is somewhat legal, sketchy, but legal, they will usually comply. It was Kiriakou that revealed the truth about the cockroaches in Zubeda's coffin and how he had an irrational fear of the things. Kiriakou said in an interview, "They put him in a coffin and poured a box of cockroaches in the coffin with him and closed it. They left him in the coffin for 2 weeks and would open it long enough to give him some water and change his diaper, and then they'd close it back up again." After Kiriakou retired from the CIA, a journalist accused him of taking part in this torture. He strenuously denied it, saying he was the only officer who was kind to the detainee. He said it was then that he figured he had to blow the whistle and let the world know that President Bush signed off on torture, and it wasn't just some rogue officers doing it. For exposing torture and various misdeeds, he later went to prison. He said he'd do it again if somehow he had the chance. Not all officers follow orders. We'll finish this on a lighter note, although we don't want to undermine what these people suffered. Nonetheless, this is interesting. An Irish vlogger who says he tests boundaries of what humans can endure said he too would inflict this torture on himself, again in a quite harmless environment, though. The man named Dara Ta said he'd shave his hair if he couldn't take an hour in the box. He did well, but he still had to shave his hair off, saying after 13 minutes he felt like he was losing his marbles. And again, we can't state enough how different the experience would be in a friendly environment. Around 100 or so people have actually died during the CIA's torture program, and many more came close to it. As for the ones that got away, many have never quite recovered the marbles they lost in those prisons. Enduring a pretend enhanced interrogation, while scary, could be compared to playing soldiers in the woods rather than fighting with real guns in a war zone. Now, you need to watch this terrifying tale inside the CIA's terrifying sleep room. Or for something lighter to watch, the CIA's secret time travel program. Real crazy research?